Hello, welcome to this video on playing bassoon in a wind quintet. I'm Terry Ewell and I welcome you to the second in this series. In this video, we're going to be discussing the unique role the bassoon has in the wind quintet. First, of course, the bassoon is the lowest sounding of the five instruments and therefore it usually carries the bass line in the quintet, and that's a very important functional role. But in addition to that, and this is what I want to concentrate most on in this video, in addition to that, it's the bassoon is a bit of a chameleon. It has this ability to blend with the other instruments in unique ways that the other instruments don't have. And I'll talk to you in this video about how to enhance that ability, the ability to blend in terms of vibrato, in terms of timbre, and in terms of articulation. You might say that the bassoon and the oboe comprise the majority instrumentation in the wind quintet. There are two double reed instruments in the wind quintet. There's a single reed, there's one flute that doesn't have a reed at all, and there's one brass instrument. So there's a sense at which the bassoon is part of the majority. But the oboe itself has such a unique sound that it itself doesn't necessarily blend with the other instruments. So the bassoon can blend with the oboe. There's things you can do on the bassoon to blend with the flute, actually both upper winds. There's things you can do to blend with the clarinet and things you can do to blend with the horn. Now, most important for blending with the clarinet and the horn is the fact that typically they are played without vibrato. So if you as a player want to match them more closely, then you need to also play without vibrato or hold your vibrato to a minimum. Take, for instance, this variation or the start of the second movement with the clarinet. In this case, I'm background to the clarinet. The clarinet takes the lead, but I purposely play with very little vibrato, if at all, so I'm matching the clarinet sound. Now you can probably see even more in variation one with the horn, how I'm trying to match the horn. Here again, I minimize my vibrato so I match the sound quality of the horn. Here is variation one. But I go beyond just matching the horn by not using vibrato. I try to match the horn in timbre. And by doing so, I'm trying to get as dark a sound on the bassoon as I can without a lot of reediness to it, but with a full, rich sound. And the way in which we can adjust to the other instruments is by adjusting the vowel in our mouth, changing that. With the horn, I use the darker vowel, the aw type sound. To get a lighter sound, I would use more of the E vowel in my mouth. This is not voicing it in my throat, but changing the tongue position. And I use that E vowel more with the upper winds when I want to blend with them, such as flute and oboe, those upper winds. And in addition, I make adjustments in the embouchure. And I want to bring to your attention an article I wrote that goes into far more detail. First off, the book is Celebrating Double Reeds. This was published by the International Double Reed Society. Highly recommend the book. I was editor of the book as well as author of a couple articles in there. The article I want to refer you to, though, however, deals with the embouchure on the bassoon. And this, for instance, has one of the plates or one of the figures in that talks about the bassoon reed and the embouchure position on the bassoon reed. I don't have time to go into full detail here, but let me just demonstrate here. So if we have your bassoon reed, and let's pretend this is your embouchure, the further your embouchure is towards the wire, the more reed material you're going to have in your mouth. And consequently, the more vibration is going to come from the reed. If you want as reedy and as rich and as maybe sham-like a sound as possible, then you want to have your lips more towards the wire. As you bring your lips back, it tends to dampen the blade more, and as a consequence, perhaps has a little bit darker sound, not quite so vibrant a sound in particular. And varying your embouchure is very helpful for playing in different dynamic ranges, but I use it a lot for playing with the different instruments. For instance, the oboist in our group has a very sonorous, a very vibrant sound, and for that reason, when I want to blend with the oboe in particular, then I am putting a little more reed in my mouth and blending with her. When I want to blend with the horn, I want it to be a little less reedy, so I'm pulling my embouchure back a little bit, and I'm changing the vowel in my mouth for more of that ah vowel to darken the sound, to mute the vibration, to try to match the horn as best I can. So I do all of that for trying to match the horn. Now, in addition to the timbre differences on the bassoon reed, I also adjust my articulation. It's very easy on the bassoon to articulate rapidly with quite a start to the note, to quite a point, as it were, to the note. When I'm performing particularly with the horn, however, I have to adjust my articulation. And I want to thank my colleagues in the quintet for even helping me rediscover this and work on this a little bit further in the context of the Nielsen Quintet. So let me give an example of where we as a quintet discussed. They helped me better match the articulation in the horn. And this is the opening of the third movement. Now, if you take the bassoon reed and you tongue right in the middle, in the center, you will get a very sharp start to the note. It will be a very, very, it sounds like a double reed. What I found is that by tonguing off to a corner, off to the side a little bit, I was able to have a softer, a more rounded release to the note, and it's better able to match the horn. So let's see if I was able to match the horn in the third movement, the opening, in terms of the quality of the tone and the start of the release. Well, that was, I hope you could hear, I was really trying to round out the tone and make for the adjustments there. If you want to have very percussive tonguing on the bassoon, of course, you can tongue right in the center, and sometimes it's very effective in the low register to pop out notes and to have that percussive tonguing. Well, here's an example of a change in timbre where I lighten my tone, and in variation 6, to match the flute, and then